Michelle Obama recently talked about white flight. She said that white people are still running from their black neighbors. Just like when she was a kid, her family would move into a neighborhood and white people would move out. You see, if white people move out of a neighborhood and black people move in, it's called white flight. If black people move out of a neighborhood and white people move in, it's called black flight. I mean, gentrification. It's confusing, I know. If white people leave and black people move into the neighborhood, blacks are somehow victims. If black people leave and white people move into the neighborhood, blacks are again somehow victims. White flight is the sudden or gradual large-scale migration of white people from areas becoming more racially diverse. But here's the thing. The only way a predominantly white area can become more racially diverse is if white people leave. Think about it. If white people don't move out of the neighborhood, minorities can't move into the neighborhood. Another interesting point is that in both scenarios, white flight or gentrification, the more minorities that are living in the neighborhood, the worse off the neighborhood is. Now, that's not what I think. That's implied by there being a problem with white flight or gentrification. Hear me out. Gentrification is the process of renovating and improving a neighborhood so that it conforms to middle-class taste, thus enticing middle-class people to move into the neighborhood. They say that's bad for minorities. So, just to make things crystal clear, renovating a bad area so that new businesses and money and people will come to the area is a bad thing, according to Democrats. I guess they'd just rather keep people living in the ghetto. And white flight wouldn't be a problem if it isn't assumed that the neighborhood changes for the worse. If a previously poor black family moves up to a middle-class neighborhood, that's a good thing, right? So why wouldn't it be a good thing if so many poor black families were able to move up to a middle-class neighborhood that they became the majority in that neighborhood? Wouldn't that also be a good thing? The example of white flight they often use is Detroit starting around the 1950s. It's true that there were about 1.5 million whites living there in 1950, and now there are only about 75,000. But the idea that they all left because they were running from black people is not taken into consideration most of the issues. The city became overpopulated. The boon from World War II had come to a halt. The auto industry went under big changes and had moved some of their plants outside of Detroit proper, taking jobs with it. And it's true that redlining made it harder for Jews and blacks to get out of the urban areas and had a big hand in turning those areas into ghettos. But white flight isn't what happened. The New Deal is what happened. And isn't it strange how Franklin Delano Roosevelt, FDR, is loved by Democrats? They rank him as the best Democratic president of all time. And his New Deal, along with other big government policies, are responsible for many of the ghettos in America. And many on the left agree that it was big government's fault. They just like to call it systemic racism. They just don't like it pointed out that the state of affairs in our inner cities are the results of their own policies. So, what is the correct percentages of different races or ethnicities that should live in a neighborhood together? Should every neighborhood have the same racial and ethnic makeup as America does? Should there be one Samoan family in every neighborhood as opposed to some of them wanting to live in the same area because they share a common history? That's why we have a Chinatown and a Little Italy and so on. My wife and daughter are Hispanic. Maybe we should live in Little Mexico. Well, I guess we kind of do. We live in California. Anyway. Now, it is true that some people want to live near their quote-unquote own kind, but there are many more people who don't care if their neighbor is a different race or ethnicity. They just want to live in a safe neighborhood. If people like Michelle Obama win the debate, everyone loses. She just bought a house in Martha's Vineyard, a place with a population that's less than 4% black. I guess she hasn't learned her lesson. Just imagine, right now all those rich white people are packing up their Ferraris and putting their mansions up for sale. Michelle once told Newsweek that she went incognito to Target and a short white person asked her to get something down from a high shelf. Michelle was quoted as saying, "Because she didn't see me as the first lady, she saw me as someone who could help her. Those kinds of things happen in life, so it isn't anything new." Unquote. She was insinuating that it was racism, that a white person couldn't see her as anything other than a servant. So, I guess that little old lady I helped at the grocery store the other day is just a short Japanese racist? Because that makes sense. I'm sure it had nothing to do with me being taller than her and standing in the same aisle when she needed help. If someone as privileged as Mrs. Obama can find a way to be a victim, think about how hard it must be for a poor young black single mom to not see herself as a victim. How hard must it be for her to change her mindset when all she's ever been told is that she's a victim? And that's what it comes down to, your mindset. It's easy to be a victim. You don't have to do anything to be a victim. It's a challenge to be a victor. For people like Michelle, who have seemingly overcome every racist obstacle in her path, to not inspire others as an example that you too can do it is such an arrogant disservice to the people she claims to care about. White people aren't running from black people, but some of us are running from the notion that we need the elite to control our lives for us. And a significant group of young black people are finally running away from the Democratic Party. The Obama presidency gave us hope and change and yes, we can, all the while trying to convince you that no, you can't. It's a real shame that a first black first family can't inspire us. What an opportunity missed. Michelle, we're not running from black people. We're running from the idea that black people or anyone else can't make it on their own. We're running from the sort of ideas that resulted in what you're actually complaining about. And that's the simple truth. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, subscribe to our channel. And if you want to become a supporting member of Blue Collar Logic, click on the link in the description